titled this morning's message, The Kingdom's Come. And we're going to be reading out of Matthew chapter 11. We're going to read Matthew chapter 11, verses 1 through 19. Here we go. And it came to pass when Jesus had made an end of commanding his 12 disciples, he departed thence to teach and to preach in their cities. Now when John had heard in the prison the works of Christ, he sent two of his disciples and said unto him, Art thou he that should come, or do we look for another? Now, let's go ahead and just stop for a second. You know we have to do this. Got to try to give a little bit of context. Now, I'm not trying to be redundant and repetitive to the point that I turn you off. I'm not trying to do that. But some of you, we've talked about this quite a bit, but then we always kind of have sometimes new people and maybe people that haven't been here at times that we talked about. That word Christ there, and literally in the Greek text, I checked it this morning, the word is written kind of like this. In the Greek, I'm not trying to get fancy on it, I'm just trying to make a point. Christu, okay? And so the way that the Greek is, the point is that it's this. And if you were to write it in English, it would be written like this. The Christ. We know, because we've taught it multiple times, that the word Christ literally means anointed one. Amen. Now, for you and I, it's easy for us to look back at the whole of Scripture and to say, yeah, that's Jesus. His name was Jesus. The Christ, the anointed one, yeah, that's him. The Old Testament Jewish people, the people that had been called by God, had been waiting all of their lives for him to arrive. Him meaning the Christ, whoever he was. They didn't know what his name was going to be. They didn't know it was going to be Yeshua, which means salvation, hallelujah, which is actually the name of Jesus, which is the same name as Joshua in the Greek. They didn't know that that was going to be his name. But what they did know was that there was one that was coming. But you also need to understand this too, because it's very relevant for the text that we're talking about this morning, that their interpretation of the Christ was going to be that he would be a ruling king. Isaiah talked about it, that the government would be upon his shoulders. Unto us a child is born, unto us a son is given. His name will be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Prince of Peace. And the government will be laid upon his shoulders. He's going to rule the earth. Multiple scriptures. He's going to rule the earth with the rod of his mouth. In other words, his word is so powerful that when he rules and reigns, the nations are going to tremble. He's the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. Amen. And so the Jewish people, the Israelites, who had experienced under the rule of David a little bit, a momentary feeling of power in the world, because whenever David was king, they had conquered a large part of the world that was known of their time. But then that quickly faded in their failure and their rebellion against God. And so now here they are under Roman rule. It's very important that you understand that you know that, right? That historically, whenever Jesus was born upon the earth, the Israelites were not a sovereign nation. Instead, they inhabited their land, but Rome was in rule. That's why it's Caesar. That's why Jesus said, who is that on that coin? Caesar. Give Caesar what is Caesar's. Give God what is God's. And the Israelites had to pay tribute to Caesar. In other words, you're going to pay Rome because we're protecting you. We've conquered the world and you belong to us. And you will. And that's where a big part came into a problem. This is just something that I'm remembering historically. That's where a big part came into problems for Christianity, because the Roman people, because the Jewish faith was already in existence whenever Christianity was born, the Romans did not make the Jews offer pagan sacrifices unto Caesar, but because Christianity was considered a new religion, they demanded that the Christians offer sacrifice unto Caesar, and that's what started much of the martyrdom that took place because the true Christians refused to do it. But there were people selling out then, just as there's people that sell out their Christianity today, that they would find little loopholes. Come on, somebody, help me out here. You know, Christians are famous for finding loopholes on how to compromise their walk with God. You know what I'm talking about? Well, anyway, I don't have to spell it out for you. You know what I'm talking about. And so what they did back then, though, is they'd find loopholes. Like, in other words, there would be the owner of a household. He happened to be a Christian. He had money. Guess what? He had servants. He would send his servant to go offer up the sacrifice to the pagan god. And in that case, he felt like, you know what? I'm not the one that did it. But the reality of it is that it was still done. And so now they didn't take any flack. I'm just trying to paint a picture for you of what it was like whenever Jesus showed up, whenever John the Baptist was preaching, that the people of God, the Israelites, were expecting a king to come to conquer Rome, to sit upon a physical throne, and to restore the kingdom. Now, you and I understand that when we read the scriptures, the Old Testament prophets, and we're going to probably get into some of that tonight when we talk about Zechariah, the Old Testament prophets prophesied in the future, not just about his first advent. What does that mean? His first coming. He will come lowly and riding on a donkey. That's his first advent. That's the first time he came. John says in the New Testament, he's coming back on a white stallion. That's the second advent. That's the second coming of Jesus Christ. See, in the first one, he came lowly and meek and led, like a lamb led to slaughter. He did not open his mouth. Right. That kingdom looked completely different than the kingdoms of this earth. There's coming another time when he's going to sit upon a literal throne and he's going to rule and reign as king sovereign upon this earth, and he's going to rule the nations with the rod of iron, and the spirit that pervades the air will no longer be the spirit of Antichrist, causing lies and deception, hallelujah, causing mankind to purposely move in the opposite. Even yourself, you ever come, just help me out a little bit here. You ever tried to have time whenever you really want to spend some time with the Lord?
Amen.
I know I'm not the only one. We all get plagued by this type of thing. Yeah. And we're over there worshiping the Lord, and then all of a sudden, some stupid, crazy thought shoots across the screen of our mind and just barges in on this holy time that we're trying to have with the Lord, and the enemy of our soul just throws that fiery dart in there. It's like, where in the world did that garbage come from? Hey, come on, somebody. And I don't know about you, but sometimes when that happens, it just disturbs my spirit so much. But the reality of it is I got good news for you. Because, see, even Christians find themselves being sometimes pushed in wrong directions, wrong pathways, by the spirit of Antichrist, that spirit that pervades the air, if you let me say it like that. But there's coming a day when that spirit is no longer going to be ruling and reigning in the air of which we live. It's going to be the spirit of the Christ, the anointed one. Amen? And his will, his heart is going to be the pervasive spirit in the air, the pervasive power that moves upon us, the Holy Spirit moving upon the hearts of people, amen, and drawing us and keeping us in close union with Jesus. The point that I'm trying to make is this, is that in this text where we are right here, that I need you to know that John the Baptist is in prison, and he's wondering, is he really the Christ? Is he really the one? Now, I don't want to get ahead of myself too much, so I'm going to keep reading. But I want you to keep that in your mind. He's in prison, and that's the question he's asking. Are you the Christ, or should we look for another? All right. So he said unto them, art thou he that should come? Verse 3, or do we look for another? Jesus answered and said unto them, go and show John again those things which you do hear and see. The blind receive their sight, and the lame walk. The lepers are cleansed, and the deaf hear. The dead are raised up, and the poor have the gospel preached to them. And blessed is he, whosoever shall not be offended in me. And as they departed, Jesus began to say unto the multitudes concerning John, what went you out into the wilderness to see? A reed shaken with the wind? But what went ye out for to see? A man clothed in soft raiment, or that means good clothes, silken clothes. Behold, they that wear soft clothing
are in king's houses. But what went you out to see? A prophet? Yea, I say unto you, and more than a prophet. For this is he of whom it is written, Behold, I send my messenger before thy face, which shall prepare thy way before thee. Verily I say unto you, among them that are born of women, there hath not risen a greater than John the Baptist. Notwithstanding, he that is least in the kingdom of heaven is greater than he. And from the days of John the Baptist until now, the kingdom of heaven suffereth violence, and the violent take it by force. For all the prophets and the law prophesied until John. And if you will receive it, this is Elias, another name, the King James Version of saying Elijah, which was for it to come. The Old Testament prophesied that Elijah would return before the coming of the Lord. He that hath ears to hear, let him hear. But whereunto shall I liken this generation? It is like unto children sitting in the markets and calling unto their fellows and saying, We have piped unto you, and you have not danced. We have mourned unto you, and you have not lamented. For John came neither eating nor drinking, and they say he has a devil. The Son of Man came eating and drinking, and they say, Behold, a man gluttonous and a winebibber, a friend of publicans and sinners. But wisdom is justified of her children. Once again, we're going to minister this morning from the title of The Kingdom's Come. And Father, I just pray that you would help me once again to speak forth your word in truth, Lord God, that your word would come forth and that your people's lives would be enriched from your word this morning. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. So what we see here is the focal point of this passage. A lot of it is really focused on John the Baptist and his ministry. Amen. And one of the things that I want to remind you about is that there were many Old Testament prophecies that spoke of a voice of one crying out in the wilderness, Prepare ye the way of the Lord. We've talked about that many times. And what we see now is that John the Baptist was the fulfillment of that prophecy that had taken place in the Old Testament. He was that voice. Amen. You know, John the Baptist, even in his early stages, we understand now the scriptures tell us that he was Jesus's cousin. Amen. And that his mother Elizabeth was barren and that she became pregnant. You remember the story that the angel Gabriel, or whenever they were told, it might not have been Gabriel. I think I'm getting confused between that and Mary right now. But when they were told that she was going to become pregnant, what ended up happening was that Zechariah, really, his daddy couldn't believe it because of the fact of that she was older in age. And because of that, he kind of chuckled a little bit because of it. He became mute. And he stayed mute until the Lord told him that he was going to name his son John. Okay? And then whenever he began to prophesy that John the Baptist was going to go before the Lord. And all of those Old Testament scriptures that he was going to cause mountains to come down. He was going to rise valleys up. The pathway that was crooked, he was going to straighten them out. And so he was in preparation. His ministry was to prepare the way for the Christ, the Messiah, which means the anointed one. Amen? And so that's what John the Baptist did. Now, if we go back and we read his story about his life, what we realize is that the Bible says that he was clothed with camel's hair, and he was clothed about with a leathern girdle or belt, okay? And then he went into the wilderness, and that the Bible says that he ate locusts, wild locusts, and honey. And, you know, if you do the research on that, some people tried to come against it, saying that locusts were unclean, but no, in reality, there were specific locusts in the book of Leviticus that they could eat. And so, literally, John the Baptist is eating wild locusts, and he's eating, partaking of honey that he's grabbing out of beehives as he lives in the wilderness, a separated life. One of the Gospels speaks of the fact that in the year that all this happened, that there were actually two high priests. There was never supposed to be two high priests, but that year the priests did what they wanted to do, and there was a father-son duo kind of thing going on there. But you know what's interesting is that the Bible says that in the year that Caiaphas and his son were high priests, that the word of the Lord came to John in the wilderness. It bypassed the religious institution. God does what he wants to do. Yeah. Mankind can sit here and he can have all this stuff going on, saying that he's preaching the gospel, saying that he's got church happening. God bypasses all of that stuff that man plans, and he moves about his business, his kingdom, the way that he chooses. Amen. And the word of the Lord came to John the Baptist in the wilderness, and he began to preach the message of the kingdom. As a matter of fact, if you turn to Matthew chapter 3, verses 1 through 2, this is what John the Baptist's message essentially was. It says in Matthew 3, verses 1 and 2, in those days came John the Baptist preaching. Well, what days is it? Well, we're in the book of Matthew, once again in the beginning, we're being introduced to the fact that Jesus has showed up on the scene. Amen? In those days came John the Baptist preaching in the wilderness of Judea and saying, repent ye, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. So one of the main emphases of John the Baptist's message is the kingdom is here. The kingdom of God that we've been waiting on is here. Now, to your mind sitting in the chair, you may say, well, Jesus isn't sitting on a physical throne yet. The kingdom isn't in its complete fulfilled place at this point in time. But the kingdom of God, and we've made this point before, was resident in Jesus when he showed up on the earth. The literal presence of God abided in him and dwelled in him. Amen. And now you and I, when we get saved by hearing the gospel of Jesus Christ and we repent, what does that mean? To change our mind, to turn our hearts. What are you talking about, change your mind? All of your life, you've grown up believing a certain thing, believing a particular mindset, believing things are the way that they should be. And in reality, the word of God is contrary to our thinking. Amen. That we received in our first birth from Adam. You know, people don't have to like that kind of preaching, but that's reality. God says, my ways are above your ways and my thoughts are above your thoughts. The message that John preached was, the kingdom of God has arrived, it's at hand, and you must repent. You must change your mindset and turn from your previous ways, and you must now enter in the way that God is going about preparing and building his kingdom. God has a specific formula for how he is going to build and prepare his kingdom upon this earth, and he will bring it to fulfillment. Amen. Oh, yeah. Just as he begins a work in your life as an individual, and he will complete it. He has begun a work upon this earth, hallelujah, corporately, and he will bring it to a place of completion. So that's the message that John preached. But now he sits in a prison. Because see, he was so bold and so confident in his message that he preached that he told King Herod, what you did is wrong. You can't just go take your brother Philip's wife as your own. No, what you did was wrong. And so now he sits in a prison, isolated. See, before he was able to live in the wilderness, he said, you know what? I don't need the religious establishment. Let me tell you something. When I started to really step back and started to realize, John the Baptist, this is a prophet. The prophets of God, it didn't always go the way that they wanted it to go. But when the Holy Spirit came upon them, amen, like the prophet Jeremiah said, his word is like a fire and it shut up in my bones. Prophet Jeremiah was trying to say, I try to hold back from saying the word of God. I'm tired of the way the people are looking at me. I'm tired of the way the people respond to the message that I preach. I'm going to hold it back. I'm going to withhold the word of the living God. And whenever I do that, it's as though a fire is shut up in my bones and I grow weary. He's saying physically, I'm growing weary from trying to hold back the word of God. It's got to come out. I've got to let it come out. Hallelujah. And the same goes for any prophet of God. When the Lord puts the word in their heart and he puts it in their mouth, they will grow weary if they don't let it come out. John the Baptist spoke the word of God.
Amen.
He spoke it in truth. He spoke it with passion. He told them, repent, for the kingdom of God has arrived. Then the Pharisees showed up. Y'all remember who the Pharisees are, right? Y'all know that. Y'all smart church. Pharisees, Sadducees, religious leaders of the day, they showed up. Let's see what's going on out here in this wilderness. They left their little religious establishment. Come on. in their soft raiment, their little silken robes and clothes with their little boxes of scripture. Sean went to a little museum over there, I think it was in Houston, the Jewish Museum. He sent me some pictures of some phylacteries, the boxes that they held their scripture in. They were holy, dude. They wore a box on their forehead with scriptures in there. We got this stuff on the frontlet of our mind all the time. Yeah, come on, somebody, help me out here. They left their religious establishment in Jerusalem in all their fancy clothes, and they walked out there to the wilderness to see what's going on. The crowds are thronging to this dude that's got eating locusts and wild honey, and he's over here preaching what's going on. John the Baptist sees him. He says, "Who told you to flee from the wrath that is to come, you brood of vipers?" Why do you think you were supposed to talk to folks like that? Especially not religious leaders. He called them a brood of vipers. And then he said, they probably started to open their mouth and say, "We're the sons of Abraham." And don't you say that you're the sons of Abraham. Because the axe is laid to the root. And any tree that's not bringing forth fruit, it will be hewn down. So basically what John the Baptist was saying is, don't you say that you come from Father Abraham, that you've been created this great nation called Israel, that you're the oracle of God, that you have the word of God, because just because you were called to be an Israelite doesn't mean you've been walking like a true Israelite was supposed to. Let me tell you what's happening. God's kingdom is at hand. You must repent. And if you are not operating the way that God desires for you to operate, the axe is being laid to the root and judgment is coming. The main point that I'm trying to make to you this morning is John the Baptist had a message that said you must repent. John the Baptist had a message that said the kingdom of God has arrived. John the Baptist had a message that pronounced judgment, but yet now he sits in a prison, silenced, isolated, wondering what in the world is going on. I saw him on the banks of the Jordan River. Maybe even saying, I don't even know exactly why I said what I said when I said the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world. You understand there's a good chance that most Israelites did not connect the sacrifice of Psalm 22. They've pierced my hands and my feet. Isaiah 53. They didn't connect that to Messiah. They connected Messiah to the one that was going to sit on the throne. But here out of John's mouth, "Behold the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world." But now he sits in a prison and he says, why in the world does Rome still rule? Why in the world do the religious leaders still have their authority? If he's the one that we were told was coming, why has nothing been changed? God told me that judgment was coming. I preached that judgment was coming. Are you really the one? And Jesus responds to him. Amen. And we're going to talk in a minute about Jesus' response to that concept. But I want to remind you of this. That just as in John the Baptist's life, what's going on with him is that things are taking an unexpected turn. And I feel like I've been saying this a lot lately. And obviously the Lord wants us to really be reminded of this. In John the Baptist's life, things are not going down the way that he expected them to go down.
Amen.
Things are somewhat different than what he expected. Amen. And it's not that he's wavering in his faith or his love for God or his love for the kingdom of God. No. He's just uncertain. It's certainly not the first time that this has ever happened to a man of God. After great victory, really, questioning and even doubt entering in. Even the prototype of John the Baptist, or the foreshadowing of a John the Baptist, the Elijah himself, the Tishbite, camel's hair, leathern belt, preaching, separated from the temples, separated from the king's palaces, out here on the fringe, preaching the gospel, having a showdown with the prophets of Baal. Remember that story. Mm-hmm. And God showed up and gave him a great victory that day. The next day, he's running from Jezebel. And he's hiding in a cave. Mm-hmm. And then hiding under a juniper tree. And thinking, "Lord, you just soon take my life," after a great victory like that. And now John the Baptist, who's been preaching in the wilderness, great victory, God used him mightily, finds himself in a prison. And there's definitely some doubt in his voice. Like, did I miss something? Is this really the way that it's supposed to be? One of the main points I wanted to make to you is that there's going to be times, and believe me, it's already happened and you know what I'm talking about, where the enemy begins to try to sneak doubt into your heart. Whatever it is that you're going through, I understand you're not John the Baptist and neither am I. I understand you're not Elijah, neither am I. But the enemy of your soul, his main objective is to make you begin to doubt God's kingdom, how God is going to work, what God is going to do, whether or not God's will is really going on in your life right now, and he's going to try to get you to doubt, and he wants to put seeds of doubt in your heart, and ultimately he wants to bring you to the place where you no longer believe, or you no longer understand, or you begin to question, and you begin to someday, hopefully, in his mind, cause you to apostatize or to turn from the faith.
Amen.
Or to say, what's this even for? What's the use? Can you imagine being in prison for preaching the truth? What's the use? Getting in a state of frustration? Nothing's happened. What? Okay, let's not even say prison. What's the use? I've been trying to live for God and nothing's going right. My finances are a mess. My relationships are a mess. What's the use? I just soon quit. Amen. I just soon give up. The enemy's trying to inject doubt inside of people's lives and in their hearts. This is Jesus' response, though, to that. Jesus answered in verses 4 through 6. And, you know, I've even thought, because the text doesn't tell you for sure, maybe it was John the Baptist's disciples that had questions. You know, maybe they were going over there to the prison and saying, John, this is the one that you backed up. Here you were in prison. What's the deal? And maybe John's like, listen, I know what I heard from God, because we're not told exactly, right? Maybe that's the way it went. And John's saying, look, you know what? You go over there and ask him. I know what the Lord told me to say. You go ask him what the deal is. And so, but anyway, this is Jesus' response. This is what you go back and you tell John. Jesus answered and said unto them, go and show John again those things which you do hear and see. The blind receive their sight, the lame walk, the lepers are cleansed, and the deaf hear. The dead are raised up, and the poor have the gospel preached to them. And blessed is he whosoever shall not be offended in me. He said, go back and tell John what you're hearing and what you're seeing. If we stay in context, this is Matthew 11, and we just reverse a little bit to Matthew 5. We talked about that here recently. You might not remember the Sermon on the Mount. Mm-hmm. One of the main things, what did Jesus say? The meek shall inherit the earth. Jesus' message sounds different. I know I say this a lot, but just bear with me for a second. He was born a babe wrapped in swaddling clothes in a manger amongst animals. The word of God says that he was the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, and that he would rule the nations with the rod of iron. How in the world does the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords of the entirety of the universe get born in a manger with a bunch of stinky animals? He rode into town on a donkey. He was rejected by the majority of people. How in the world does this happen? Because his kingdom that John the Baptist is announcing and doesn't even realize it is different than the kingdoms of the earth. And so what's happening here is go tell him what you're hearing. Tell him what I said on the mountain over there. Tell him what you're hearing and tell him what you're seeing. Not only shall the meek inherit the earth, but people's lives are being changed. Miracles are taking place. The blind see, the deaf hear, the lame walk, the dead receive life again. Now I have to tell you that there's multiple passages of scripture in the Old Testament, specifically in the prophet Isaiah, that speak of the blind receiving their sight. Now, one of the things that I want to point you to is and also that the gospel is being preached to the poor. Jesus actually referred to the Isaiah passage in Luke chapter 4. Remember when he said, the Spirit of the Lord is upon me. He has anointed me to preach the good news. Amen. To set at liberty those that are captive. To allow those that are blind to receive their sight. But in Isaiah, I want to turn, maybe you can put Isaiah 35 up there for us, Sandy, real quick. Isaiah 35, verses 4 and 5. Because I just want to show you something. You know, the prophet Isaiah was prophesying during that time frame whenever Israel was being disobedient to God. And there were two messages that were being spoken, kind of similar to John the Baptist. One was, it was a message of judgment. You have to turn from the way that you're going. But also a message of hope that God always will have a remnant and that he will restore his people. Amen? Yeah. And the way that he was going to restore them was that there were many messianic or Christ, the Christ, anointed one, prophecies. He was going to be God's salvation. Amen? And so that's what the people were waiting for. And so in Isaiah 35, verses 4 and 5, it says, "Say to them that are of a fearful heart, be strong, fear not. Behold, your God will come with vengeance, even God with a recompense. He will come and save you." Now let's just stop a second, because I didn't really feel like, I didn't expect to go here, but this goes along with what the Lord's already said this morning. So this is 600 years prior to what we're reading this morning. Does that make sense? The prophet Isaiah is about 600 BC, somewhere around there. Probably more like, about 600 BC. And we're reading from the time frame of Jesus. So 600 years before, this is what one of the prophets said. And what he was telling them was, is that you're about to go into Babylonian, before he's already said it in this book, you're about to be brought into captivity of your enemy, all right? And now he's saying, say to them that are a fearful heart. So you've heard the word that I've given you, you're going to be brought captive. And I know that fear is trying to strike your heart, but this is the word that I have for you. Be strong. Why? Fear not. Why? Behold, your God is going to come with vengeance. Even God with a recompense. We're going to restore you. God's going to restore you. He's going to come with vengeance upon your enemy, and he's going to rescue you.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. He will come and save you. Yeah. Don't be fearful, even though you've been disobedient, even though you've gone the wrong way, and I'm allowing the enemy to bring you captive. Hold on. Don't be fearful. Don't give up. I'm going to save you, and I'm going to come with vengeance upon your enemy. Hallelujah. And so what I'm trying to tell you is that he's already introduced also in this book, Messiah. This is the same book that says, "Unto us a son is born. Unto us a child is given." So the readers of this book, whether we do it or not, they've already been introduced to the idea of Messiah's coming. And he will be the one that's going to save us. And he's going to be the ruler and the king. And now the prophet's saying, "I'm going to come and save you." So this is connected again to Messiah. Look what he says. "Then the eyes of the blind shall be opened, and the ears of the deaf shall be unstopped." Verse 6. "Then shall the lame man leap as a hart, and the tongue of the dumb sing. For in the wilderness shall waters break out and streams in the desert." Now, what I want to tell you is this. God is so good that he's over here. Because the kingdom looks so different. And I'm telling you, what we think when we flip through the channels, like, "Oh man, that's church right there, bro. Look at that. Look at that, man. That auditorium got 25,000 people in it. And it looks so successful. And it looks like that's, in reality, that's what the religious establishment of Israel looked like. And the real church was happening in the wilderness with some man wearing camel hair and eating wild honey and locusts. And the reality of it is that the majority of people don't know how to see the difference between the two. Okay? And so what I am trying to say is this, is that Jesus shows up and he is literally causing blinded eyes to be opened. Come on, blind Bartimaeus. "Oh, son of David, have mercy on me," as he sits on the side of the road, life passing him by. Nobody's stopping to help him. And even Jesus' own disciples say, "Hey, hush your mouth and be quiet." The Bible says he cried out all the more. "Oh, son of David, have mercy on me." Hallelujah. And Jesus reached down and touched old blind Bartimaeus. Changed his life. Allowed his eyes to be opened, hallelujah. And then look, nobody else was going to give him any time of day. Nobody else was going to help him. Amen. You know, I want to encourage you right there. I didn't feel like the Lord, I didn't plan on talking about blind Bartimaeus, but what I will tell you is this. Sometimes we find ourselves in a situation, ain't nobody stopping to help. Ain't nobody really reaching out to us. And as a matter of fact, we want to cry out and the enemy of your soul tell you to shut up. Keep your mouth shut. God ain't worried about you. You turned your back on him. You did him dirty. God gave up on you. No, that's the wrong attitude. That's the wrong spirit. All the more be like blind Bartimaeus. In your desperation, cry out to God. "God, oh son of David, have mercy on me." Amen. Reach down and he will touch you.
Amen.
And he will make you whole. Don't let the enemy lie to you as you sit in your prison cell like John the Baptist, beginning to doubt what's really going on here. No, God is real. His kingdom is real. He's got a plan. But I want you to think about something. Because see, there was a time whenever I was blind. but now I see.
Amen.
There was a time whenever I was lame. I couldn't walk to save my life. But now, hallelujah, I can walk. There was a time whenever I was dead, but now I've been raised to life again.
Amen.
Jesus, yes, he's over here and he's providing physical miracles of eyes that could not previously see, ears that could not previously hear, feet that could not previously walk. But I need to tell you something. The modern church is still so hungry to see that kind of stuff right there. They're running to and fro to different meetings and this. I just want to see somebody come back from the physical dead. Hold on a second. What about the fact that you used to be spiritually dead? Hallelujah. And then when the gospel reached into your heart, it changed things. It woke you up from your death slumber. Amen. And it caused you to stand up, rise up, and to begin to walk.
Yes.
What I want to tell you is this. Is that whenever you find yourself in that proverbial prison cell, like John the Baptist, and the enemy is trying to put doubt inside of your heart. Two things to remember. Number one, the kingdom doesn't always look exactly like we thought. Sometimes things are not going to be the way we wanted them to be.
Yeah.
Number two, remember the miracles. Amen. Remember where you used to be and remember what God's brought you.
Amen.
Remember what God's done in your life. Remember that there was a time when you really could not see anything connected to the things of God. But now your eyes have been opened.
Yes.
Are you exactly where you want to be? None of us are. Hopefully we're on the path of heading in the direction where God desires for us to be. You know, there's a process that takes place where we're being conformed, molded into the image of our glorious Savior.
Amen.
The Holy Spirit, through the ministry of the Holy Spirit through the Word of God, as we keep our faith in what Jesus did for us at the cross, it gives us a place of righteousness and it allows us access into the presence of God. In the presence of God, our lives are molded.
Yes.
Our lives are changed in the image of our glorious Savior. Amen. So I wanted you to be aware of that. At the end of that passage, he says right here, he says in verse 6, "And blessed is he whosoever shall not be offended in me." How many times, you know, the word offended, it comes from this Greek word scandalizo, which actually describes a stick in a trap. Back in the day, they set the snare, right? And they put like a little bait, and it was some kind of stick apparatus. I couldn't, if I had to make one of them, I'd starve. Some of you guys, I know y'all figure it out. But the point is that that's what it was. It was a trip up. It was a trick. It was a stumbling block. It would snare you and cause you to fall. Jesus said, "Blessed are those that won't be tripped up because of me." In other words, the context has to do with the fact, I believe, John the Baptist is in prison now and things are not going the way that he expected them to go. And Jesus says, you go back and you tell him what you heard and you tell him what you see. And you also tell him, blessed are those who are not tripped up because of me. How many times have Christians expected things to go one way, and when it didn't go the way they wanted it to go, what did they do? They blamed it on God and they got offended by God. They got tripped up, they fell down, and some of them never got back up and continued to walk with the Lord. I remember, and sometimes I use this example too much, but I remember when I told somebody this at the clinic the other day. They were talking to me about things that were going on in their life and how tragedy had, stricken their life. And I told them about my sister and how she died tragically. And I can just remember when I look back on it now, I realize that there was two ways that I could have gone in that tragedy. Number one was I could have blamed God. I could have blamed God. And believe me, I thought in my mind many things. I mean, I don't want to get all detailed about it, but God could have allowed multiple things to happen to stop it. Why didn't he? All I'm trying to make a point is that I question stuff. But ultimately, when it was all said and done, you know what the Lord kept doing to my heart? He kept saying, you're focused on that. But what I need you to see is I need you to see yourself, man. I need you to see. Now, this might be hard for you to be able to handle, but I'm just telling you what the Lord spoke to me. I need you to see what you didn't do, what you were supposed to do. I need you to see where you failed.
I need you to see, and I'm not, and you know what? God never condemned, I never felt like it was all my fault, never felt that. God knows how to talk to people a whole lot better than I do, all right? But his point was, is that, Matt, you didn't do everything right. You weren't living your life right. You were judging her. You were hypocritical towards her. You didn't do what you were supposed to do. I put you here. I revealed things about myself to you. And instead of you being focused on what you should have been doing to help, what you did was you were just focused on your own self. And so in reality, you did have a part to play in this. And, you know, that's kind of hard. But at the same time, if you're willing to receive the correction of the Lord, it's like medicine for your soul.
Amen.
Amen. It's like medicine for your soul. See, nobody wants to take responsibility for their own actions.
Amen.
And, you know, people put it on Facebook, oh, well, you know, somebody put a quote, I'm not going to even say it because I feel weird saying it. But, I mean, there was a preacher, I'm going to say his name, Stephen Furtick. If you've been watching that garbage, you need to turn that off. And I'm going to look in the camera and tell you, if you're watching that garbage, modern day gospel, contemporary garbage, the dude said C-R-A-P from the pulpit. Is that okay? I mean, it's not okay in my book. I gotta spell it, okay? I know some of you say it, okay? But I can't say that. I haven't said it as a Christian. But I feel weird if I say it now. I feel really weird if I said it from the pulpit.
Amen.
All right? He says, if you're really a Christian, then quit treating people like C-R-A-P. And everybody's like, oh, man, that's beautiful. That's deep. Man, we're getting deep now. No, and you know what the crazy thing is that they were actually slinging it at somebody on purpose. And what they don't even realize is that they also are treating people like CRAP. But they can't even see their own selves because they're so focused on what other people are supposedly doing to them. No, you have a responsibility in this situation because it ain't everybody else's fault because you ain't 100% the way you're supposed to be. God's wanting to deal with you, honey. God's wanting to deal with you, sir. It's your heart if you cry out to God and say, Lord, change me, okay? You're my child. You want me to change you? You think it's going to look like the way you expected it to look? No, there's a whole lot of ugly in you, son. There's a whole lot of ugly in you, daughter. And guess what? We'll allow trials and tribulations to come in your life to try cause this stuff to rise up to the top. Just like, what did he say in the proverb? He said, you remove the dross away from the metal and comes forth the vessel for the finer, or modern English, the refiner. Dross is impurities. Impurities that are in metal. You light a fire under metal and you turn it up hot enough, guess what happens? It turns into a liquid state, and impurities that are lighter begin to rise to the top where it can be seen, skimmed off, removed from the elements of the vessel, then a new vessel created that's worthy of the refiner's use. What does that mean? The refiner knows exactly what's in that thing. He's the one that stoked the fire. He's the one that skimmed the top. He's the one that took that pure metal now and made a vessel out of it that he can drink through. God's doing a work in the hearts and lives of his people. When they cry out to him, I can remember praying that prayer one time. This ain't got nothing to do with my message. I remember praying that prayer one time, Lord, make me look more like Jesus. And I can remember distinctly the Lord saying, you want that? That's what you were asking for. Because I can assure you, this is what I felt in my spirit, it's not going to be what you thought. It's not going to look like what you... Do you remember what they did to my son? Do you remember how they treated him? Do you remember the anguish that he felt when he was in Gethsemane? Do you remember how the blood poured from his face? Do you remember how they looked at him and plucked the whiskers out of his beard and thrust that crown of thorn upon his head? That's what you're asking for? I can assure you that there's going to be things that are going to happen in your life. And listen to me, child of God. The reason God allows it to happen is not because he doesn't love us.
Amen.
It's not because he's against us.
Right.
It's because he does love us.
That's right.
He chastens those whom he loves.
Amen.
And he's trying to show us things that are in us. Listen to me. There's things in you and there's things in the preacher. I didn't even realize it was there.
Yeah.
Sometimes we're just doing so good with the Lord. We know so much about the gospel now, and we're just trucking along on cruise control, and we think that we just got something figured out, and all of a sudden the Lord allows things to happen in your life that begin to reveal things to you, things that you didn't even know were there. And God wants to deal with that stuff because he's conforming us into the image of his glory.
victorious.
Amen.
So, once again, when you find yourself inside that prison cell, like John the Baptist, isolated, silenced, not understanding why the kingdom doesn't look the way you thought it was going to look, wondering, oh, is this even real? Is it even worth it? You know, is it worth it to really wait? I can't help myself. I think that a lot of times where people really deal with, where do people really deal in practical life on a daily basis? What is most people's struggles? What would you say? I would say relationships and finances are a big thing, right? I mean, when you get past addictions,
yeah.
Most of society is addicted nowadays. And when you get past addictions, people struggle with relationships and finances. Most of the time, people make stuff happen. And I guess what I'm trying to say is, if I was going to try to make it relevant from a practical perspective, how many times do people try to force a situation to go get them in a relationship?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. I need a man. I need a woman. And they don't wait on the Lord. They don't really wait on the Lord. And what ends up happening is they create a big old mountain of chaos.
Amen.
Okay. Finances. I got to write this and stuff. I need this. I need that. They don't really wait on the Lord because their flesh doesn't really want to hear what God has to say. I mean, really, if you think about it, if you want a car or a new house, or for me lately, for some reason, I'm just being transparent, I've been thinking about going to get me a custom-made suit. Why? I never even liked suits before. What's wrong with you, dude? But my point is this. I might walk up in this place one day with a custom-made suit, but I guarantee you I'm going to have saved the money to pay for it.
Yeah.
My point is this. Why do we do that? I don't want to hear what you got to say. If I want a custom-made suit, I'm going to get me a custom-made suit. And if I want to get me a new car, I want to go get me a new car. Don't want to wait on the Lord. Don't want to wait on His timing. Create more financial mess for myself than what I had on the front end. Because it's not working out the way that I expected it. See? And so anyway, that was a little line out for free. I don't know if you liked it or not. But anyway, that was what that was about. All right. So it's because, once again, it's not going the way I expected it. And I'm not waiting on the Lord. And so therefore, I go and I force something and make something happen. Does that make sense how I tied that in? All right. Matthew chapter 11, verses 7 through 8. Now, at the same time, Jesus is wanting to make sure that, hey, I don't want you to take me wrong. You need to not misunderstand John the Baptist, because he was a man. He's a man of God. And so Jesus is coming back and he's going to talk a little bit about John the Baptist. In verses 7 and 8, he says, "And as they departed, Jesus began to say unto the multitudes concerning John, what went you out into the wilderness to see?" Here's a question. "A reed shaken with the wind? But what went you out to see? A man clothed in soft raiment? Behold, they that wear soft clothing are in kings' houses." So John may be asking some questions here, but you need to understand something about John the Baptist. Number one, when you went out to see him in the wilderness, did you think that you were going to hear a man who was changing his mind like a reed that's waving in the wind? See, a reed is, you ever been in the marsh? And they got these reeds that grow, and these little light ones, sometimes they're a little bit stiff, but some of them are real thin. And not only will they wave in the wind, they'll go whichever way the wind's blowing, but it doesn't take a whole lot to actually break one over. Jesus is trying to let us know, John the Baptist wasn't like a reed that was moving in the wind. He didn't move from side to side based on public opinion. His message stayed the same the entire time. It didn't matter who he was talking to. It didn't matter if it was Herod. It didn't matter if it was people in the wilderness. It didn't matter if it was those Pharisees that showed up. This is the message. Repent. The kingdom of God is at hand. Hallelujah. And judgment is coming, and the axe is laid to the root. The message will not change. He's not a reed that's moving in the wind. And guess what? The true prophet of God also is not, the true child of God is not going to be moved by public opinion. It doesn't matter what the modern church says the way we ought to preach the gospel is. It doesn't matter what the modern church says about how we ought to reach out in their way to bring in other people. That's another thing recently that's been going on. There's a situation where, look, social media, I got off of it, okay? But because it was grieving me. Because I got a big mouth and I think I was making myself look stupid. But anyway, I got off of it. I've been off of it for over a year now, all right? I'm glad. Less grief in my life. But, you know,
there was a situation where in a community, there's a church that's a full gospel type church that connected themselves with another church who went and had a service in a Catholic church. And so everybody in the community is just loving it. Oh man, look, we have unity. We're all coming together and we're finding unity. And so one of this person that I know who I respect very much said, unity? You call this unity? This isn't, they don't believe in the same Jesus that we believe in. And the next thing you know, you got a firestorm on your hand. Oh, this one, some dude comes back and says, I heard a message by John. Not John, whatever the dude's name. What's the Pope's name now? Francis. Yeah. I think it was Francis. He might have said John. I don't know. I heard a message by the Pope and it was anointed by the Spirit. Okay, I'll tell you one thing. It might have been a spirit that anointed it, but it wasn't the Holy Spirit, because I'm going to tell you right now, that ain't the same Jesus. People don't like this kind of talk. Back in the church that I used to go to, I can't tell you how many times I talked to the preacher. And I'm like, hold on a second, dude. What are you doing? You're over here in a certain way promoting Catholicism. Listen, you think that I'm mad at Catholics? I was born and raised Catholic. I am not mad at Catholics. I'm here to tell you it is not the same as Christianity. It is not apostolic Christianity. Listen to me. They believe that being born again is a baby sprinkled in water. Don't tell me that's not what they believe, because that's what they said at my daddy's funeral, and I went back and I read it for myself in their catechism. That is not how a person is born again. You're not born again as a baby sprinkled with water. You're born again as an adult when you hear the gospel of Jesus Christ and you give your heart to the truth. Yeah. And so the next thing you know, even something going on with this rock thing. Oh, the rocks are so beautiful. Maybe we could all come together in unity. But what we need to do is we need to let that preacher from that church come, that preacher from that, and the Catholics will feel more comfortable if we bring them. Oh, this would be so good if we did that. We'll come together in unity. Rick Warren in his peace plan said this: we can all come together with people of faith. It doesn't matter what their faith is in, as long as they have faith, we can come together. Garbage, lies, amen. False doctrine, a wolf in sheep's clothing. Amen. Listen to me, people. There's a spirit of Antichrist that is moving people to come together under a false sense of unity. We are unified together as we keep our eyes focused on Jesus Christ and Him crucified. Amen. When we start trying to look at unity with one another instead of unity with Jesus, see, if we all turn our eyes upon the Lamb of God, then we're going to be in unity with the right thing. Amen. But if we start trying to focus on being in unity with a whole people, a bunch of people that don't, for the sake of unity, now we're not looking at Jesus. The gospel says what the gospel says, amen?
Amen.
The apostle Paul, listen, Rick Warren's telling us we can, specifically with Muslims, we can work with Muslims because they're people of faith. The apostle Paul said in 1 Corinthians chapter 10, let's go there. 1 Corinthians 10. What are we talking about right now? We're talking about the fact that a reed shakes in the wind, and based on public opinion, people's message changes, and people's ways of doing ministry changes, but John the Baptist never changed. Right. Jesus never changed. The gospel doesn't change. God doesn't change. He's the same yesterday, today, and forever. He said, preach my gospel, hallelujah. And upon the revelation that he gave Peter, that he was the Son of the living God, upon that truth, upon that rock, God would build his church, and the gates of hell will not prevail against it, hallelujah. We need to preach the truth.
Amen.
We need to stick to the truth. And we need to be unified in the truth. It says in 1 Corinthians 10, if I can even find it. Look at this right here. 1 Corinthians 10, verse 19. What say I then? That the idol is anything, or that which is offered in sacrifice to idols is anything. But I say that the things which the Gentiles, that's people of that day that didn't know the God of Israel, okay? The thing that the Gentiles sacrifice, they sacrifice to devils and not to God. And I would not that you should have fellowship with devils. Listen to me. The Apostle Paul is being real clear. People that are worshiping
other gods are worshiping devils. They don't know it. Do they know it? No, they don't know it. The Muslims that I talk to in the clinic that bring me back presents from Jordan and Petra and all this stuff that I have conversations with, that I tell them that Jesus is the way. And they hold on to Allah. Do they know that Allah is really not the same God as Abraham believed in? No. They believe the lie. They don't know that Allah was a moon deity and just another demonic God that the people that don't know any better were worshiping. But the God of Islam is not the God that we serve. The Jesus of the Jehovah's Witnesses is not. They say he came from the Archangel Michael. Did you know that? That's not the same Jesus.
Right.
Hello? It's not the same Jesus. The Mormons say that Jesus and Satan were brothers. Hello? That's not the same Jesus. And we cannot be in unity with people that are serving and worshiping false gods.
Amen.
John the Baptist wasn't a reed that was swayed by public opinion. There's a move by the spirit of Antichrist that's trying to bring everybody
together. That's right.
Bring everybody together. And preachers like your preacher that are over here saying you got to be separated. We need to get rid of those kind of preachers. I'm here to tell you that if the Lord tarries, there won't be many left.
That's right.
And as the preacher, the pulpit goes, so shall the people go.
Amen.
We got to stay true to the word of God.
Amen.
Lord, help us.
Yeah.
He wasn't a reed shaking with the wind. He didn't change his message based upon public opinion or however the wind would blow. But he wasn't a man clothed in soft raiment. He didn't do what everybody else did. While everybody else was worried about silk and clothes, might be able to learn something from John the Baptist. He put on his camel's hair and he went into the wilderness. While everybody else was over there saying, oh, look at this pretty religion over here, John the Baptist was out here saying, no, this is the right way. He did not go by public persuasion. He was not part of the world system. And in a similar fashion, you and I are not supposed to be part of the world system.
Amen.
I'm not saying you can't go buy a silk blouse. I'm trying to say that we're not supposed to be part of what the world is doing. Does that make sense,
right?
What I'm trying to say?
Amen.
All right.
Yeah.
Praise God. Hallelujah. All right. Let's go on. Thank you, Jesus. Verses 9 through 14. So Jesus is still on John the Baptist. He says, but what went you out to see? A prophet? Yea, I say unto you, and more than a prophet, for this is he of whom it is written, behold, I send my messenger before thy face, which shall prepare thy way before thee. Verily I say unto you, among them that are born of women, there hath not risen a greater than John the Baptist. Notwithstanding, he that is least in the kingdom of heaven is greater than he. And from the days of John the Baptist until now, the kingdom of heaven suffered violence, and the violent take it by force. For all the prophets and the law prophesied until John. And if you will receive it, this is Elias or Elijah, which was for to come. Now, let's just slow down a little bit. See, I like some of this stuff here because, to be honest with you, these are passages of Scripture that I never really understood a whole lot before. And so now that I understand, I want to slow down, or at least I feel like I understand them. I want to slow down, and I want to kind of look at them a little bit closer. It says, what did you go out to see? You didn't go see a man, a reed shaking in the wind. You didn't go see somebody wearing silky clothes. Instead, you went to go see a prophet. He said, you know what? There was really no greater prophet than John the Baptist. John the Baptist is not so much that he was more holy than Isaiah that made him greater. John the Baptist, oh man, he had the greatest ministry that any prophet could have. I don't care who you say you think the greatest prophet was. There was no prophet like John the Baptist. Let me tell you why. Look right here where it says right here. For all the prophets and the law prophesied until John. See that? For all the prophets and the law. Prophets and the law. What does that mean? What's he talking about right there? If you connect those two together, what do you think that means? Anybody? Throw something out.
The law of God and the prophets of old.
The prophets.
The law of God, the prophets of old. So then what this describes is the Old Testament.
Yes.
The Old Testament records, the Old Testament word.
The whole Old Testament, amen? The word that was given by God. I keep using this word a lot because I want to get it in your head. God used Israel as his oracle, his mouthpiece. The whole Old Testament right here prophesied. What did it prophesy? It prophesied about the kingdom. It prophesied about Messiah. So all this time, it's prophesying. The Old Testament is prophesying. The Old Testament prophets are prophesying. They're telling us Messiah is coming. The Christ is coming. The kingdom's coming. But there's none like John the Baptist. Because John the Baptist said, he's here! The kingdom of God is at hand! It's here! Messiah has shown up! Hallelujah! The one that we've been waiting for! He finally arrived! Nobody else was given a ministry like John the Baptist. He was able to speak forth the truth. And since John the Baptist, Jesus said, the kingdom of God suffers violence.
Yes.
The kingdom's here! The kingdom's come! And since John the Baptist, the kingdom of God has suffered violence. In other words, the establishment don't want to see this. There's somewhere in here, and I can't remember exactly where it is. It's just coming to my mind that I used to read it and go back and find it from time to time. There's literally a spot in one of the Gospels where the Pharisees say, the people keep saying he's the son of David. We got to do something because what's going to happen to our position? Just hold on a second. Stop. Slow down. Did you just say that? All of your life, you've been being trained as a little child that one day God's going to send Messiah and he's going to establish his kingdom upon this earth. And now John the Baptist is preaching it. The people are responding. They're realizing his genealogy comes from David. The miracles are being performed. And you're worried about your position? You're worried about the fact that you're going to lose your position? Lord, help us. But yet, that's what they're doing. The kingdom's come and the law and the prophets prophesied. And since John announced the arrival, the kingdom of God has been suffering violence. Because it's not the way that they wanted it to be. The religious establishment didn't want it to be that way. And the kingdom of God, the true kingdom of God, is still suffering violence today. And the way that it's suffering violence is that the enemy will not stop. Just as he filled up those lying Pharisees and Sadducees in Jesus' day, he's filling up pulpits with lying preachers today. Whether it be a contemporary modern movement that makes everybody feel all gooey on the inside and comfy and act like everything's just fine when in reality it's not. Or another lying gospel that says we can all come together and we can believe with people that just have faith. It don't matter that they're worshiping devils. The kingdom of God is suffering violence. And when you find a preacher that'll tell you that the true gospel is about Jesus Christ and him crucified, and you're out there and you're trying to talk to some, I was going to call somebody a nimwit. I know, repeated, that's an old word, right? I know you don't be cool, you don't say nimwit. Okay, well, I said nimwit, that means I'm not cool. Some nimwit, whoever some is, and you're trying to say, man, do you understand the cross? And when they turn around and tell you it's the cross, dude, that's old, whoa, that's past miseries, man. We're moving on to resurrection life. No, you don't even know anything. You don't know anything about the gospel. And you're trying to talk to people about that, and they're coming against the truth of the gospel that says the old man born of Adam must die. Before there can ever be a true resurrection, there's got to be a crucifixion. You got to die, man. The problem is that you haven't died yet. That's why you're so worried on the Facebook about talking about how other people are treating other people when you also are treating people wrong. Because you ain't dead. And we all need to be in the process of dying.
Amen.
Guess what? The preacher ain't completely dead either, but at least I know it. Amen. Quit walking around here thinking like you got everything figured out. Lord, help us.
Amen.
Amen. Thank you, Jesus. So the kingdom of God suffers violence. Now, the last part of this passage is in verses 16 through 19. And this is what Jesus says. After he puts all this together, John the Baptist is questioning what's going on. It doesn't look like I thought it was. At the same time, Jesus wants us to know John the Baptist was a prophet of God. He had the most astounding ministry. Amen. And he didn't vacillate like a reed in the wind.
Let me just tell you, it wasn't John the Baptist that's the problem, it's this generation that's the problem. And Jesus begins to explain the generation. I love this passage of scripture right here because I used to read it so many times that I didn't really understand it. You know how it is when you read something and you just kind of pass over it? Sometimes it's got such richness in it and it's got such good truth in it. So I'm excited about this. Yeah, you may not be, but I am. It says in verses 16 through 19, whereunto shall I liken this generation? And you know what? The same generation lives today because the same spirit prevails today, that the lion spirit that would cause people to not want to go to the words of the truth. He says, this is the generation. It's like unto children sitting in the markets and calling unto their fellows and saying, we have piped unto you and you have not danced, and we have mourned unto you and you have not lamented. Well, what in the world does that mean? Okay, we'll just try to picture this. You're in a marketplace. And the parents are over there trying to buy vegetables or getting them a piece of lamb as they're like shooing the flies away off the meat. And running around, but there's also, they got to bring their kids with them because they don't have daycare, they don't have nannies. And the kids are playing around in the marketplace. And the kids get together and they play games of what common things are going on during that time frame. And what they're talking about when they say piped, it's descriptive of the music that would be played at a wedding. And when they say, we've piped for you, and you have not danced. We mourn for you, and you have not lamented. So the piping was symbolic of a music that was played for a wedding, and the mourning was symbolic of a dirge or a funeral song. And so basically what's happening is that the kids are saying, hey, let's play this game. And so what's supposed to happen is in their culture, if somebody played wedding music and they started to dance, everybody was supposed to dance, right? Because that was the respectful thing to do. If you happen to be in the proximity of a lamenting or a mourning where a funeral dirge was being played, then you would mourn along with the people. And so the kids are in the market and they're saying, let's play the wedding thing. And boop, 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 we're playing the pipes. And everybody just kind of sitting around. We don't want to play your stupid game. Well, okay, well, you don't want to do the marriage game. Well, let's play a sad song like we're at a funeral. Come on, let's play this game. We don't want to mourn with you. And so Jesus is saying, this generation is like that. Here these kids are trying to play this game. They're trying to play a happy song. Oh, no, 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 we don't want to play that game. Okay, well, let's play a sad song. Oh, no, 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 we don't want to play that game. Jesus said, the generation is just like those people that don't want to play with those kids. And this is why. For John came neither eating nor drinking, and they said that he had a devil. And the Son of Man came eating and drinking, and they say, behold, a gluttonous and a wine bibber, a friend of publicans, which is a tax collector, and sinners. But wisdom is justified of her children. What is he saying? John the Baptist came, and what he desired to do was to separate himself from the religious establishment and to live a life that was separated and holy unto God. But what did the people do? Yes, some crowds flocked to him. Some people received his ministry. But the reality of it is that many people, especially the religious, said that he was full of a devil. And the truth will go for you too, believe me. Whenever you start trying to take a stand, listen to me. You know, the Holy Spirit will put certain things on your heart and reveal to you that it's not right. I used it last week. I'm going to use it again. It's on tape this time. There was a time when I used to run around without my shirt on in the neighborhood. It bothered Robert. I wasn't convicted of it. But it bothered Robert. Maybe my conscience was seared. I don't know. I'm not telling you can't run without your shirt on. That's between you and Jesus. No, well, please. you understand what I'm saying. Lord help me. The point that I'm trying to make is that sometimes there's things that are going on in our life and we may not feel convicted about it, but the Holy Spirit is convicting you about it. And whenever you take a stand against it,
yes.
Guess what? Sometimes people are going to look down on you. They're like, oh, you self-righteous, think you know this, that, or the other thing. You see what I'm getting at?
Yes.
And the reality of it is that I believe that we just have to be careful about the way we explain it. Now, Robert never said it to me in a way that he was being self-righteous. He really did. Most of the time he said it in a joking way, but I knew it bothered him. All right. But at the same time, you guess what? You will also have a situation where there will be times in your life, if the true Jesus gets a hold of your heart, where you will find yourself in the presence of people that aren't free yet. You will find yourself ministering to people that are still hurting, people that are still bound up. And whenever people on the outside see that, they're going to judge you for that too. And what Jesus was saying is, it don't matter if we play a wedding song and make you happy. It don't matter if we play a funeral song and make you sad. You just don't want to be involved in it. Wisdom can understand and perceive the difference between the two. That God's kingdom hallelujah, separates itself from unholiness while at the same time ministers to those that are hurting. Yes. Amen. And that's what the word, that's what the wisdom of God would teach each and every one of us. All right. Praise God. So I just got four things that I want us to try to remember. Number one, God's kingdom won't always look like what I expected, but the message will never change. He's asking people to repent and enter through faith. Amen. If you get a hold of a message that's telling you that you can just stay all the same and that you nothing has to change, hallelujah, then I'm telling you right now, it's not the right message and it's not the right gospel, and it's not, can't just be faith in anything. It has to be faith in Jesus Christ, the anointed one, and Him crucified, His sacrifice that paid the penalty for our sin. Number two, when the enemy has you backed up and is putting doubt in your mind, remember the miracles. Amen. Remember that you were blind, but now you see. Remember that you used to be deaf, but now you hear. Remember that there was a time when you couldn't walk, but now you can. Amen. Hallelujah. Number three, the true prophet of God and the true child of God, for that matter, doesn't change their message based on public opinion. The gospel is the gospel, and he won't sell out.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. We need to learn what the truth of the gospel is saying so that we can know whenever those out there that we're talking to are saying something that isn't right. Lord, help our attitudes to be right whenever we begin to confront those situations or whenever the Lord leads us to take a stand against it, because people do need to know the truth. Verse 4, there's been a spiritual war raging in the heavenly realm, and John the Baptist announced the arrival of Messiah and kingdom. You can expect that people will oppose it, and they will oppose you. You can expect, as just as they didn't want to play the games with the kids in the markets, there will be many that don't want to follow you into the kingdom. Amen. How many times have you tried to, with passion and with joy, like a little kid would want to play a game, tried to tell somebody about the, what God's done in your life, and they just shoot you down? You see the sad little face on that kid whenever he was trying to get people to play with him and nobody wanted to play with him? And it's the same thing with, I don't know about you, but if I'm excited about the things of God and I'm trying to tell somebody about it and they shut me down, it kind of hurts. Expect it. Not everybody's going to follow. Yeah. Not everybody's going to come. But hallelujah, it's the truth. Yeah. And we're going to stick with it. Amen. Amen.